Welcome to GamedayU, powered by Hebert Financial. We are back here in Norman, Oklahoma, after our road trip last week to Knoxville, Tennessee, where the Sooners eked out a win to remain undefeated, 31-24. I'm here, as always, joined by Carson Williams, Reagan Ledbetter, and Clarke Sacks. We're back in Norman. How's it feel to be home?
Feels good. You know, last week was very exciting. Just glad to be back. Perfect football weather today, Mason.
Great environment last week, Reagan.
Something about game day in Norman, but I mean, there's a lot of excitement about this football team now after that big win last week. I'm excited to see how this team comes out and homecoming. Here we go. Yeah.
100th consecutive sellout, Clarke.
Yeah, big game for Stoops. He's a 100th game at OU and 100th sellout. Not many people would have thought that was happening when Stoops came in at 99.
That's right, absolutely. Yeah. We're going to talk more about OU later, but right now it's around the nation. The biggest game's going on today. We will start first with number 18, Auburn, versus number 13, LSU. LSU's 6.5-point favorite. Auburn had a tough time last week against Jacksonville State. LSU 1-0 after their first game got suspended due to rain. What are you looking for out of this game?
I'm looking for quarterback Jeremy Johnson for Auburn. You know, he hasn't been very good this year so far. Many people thought he was going to be a, you know, Heisman candidate, but he really hasn't been so far. That's kind of concerning to me. Auburn hasn't won in Death Valley since 99, and I don't really see that happening again today.
That's right. Auburn since 99 hasn't won in Death Valley.
It's a tough place to play no matter who you are. But I mean, after that game last week, I mean, Jacksonville State, really? I mean, come on. Leonard Fournette's home, put up some good numbers last week.
Yeah.
It's going to be his day to shine in Death Valley tonight.
Yeah, people started sweating there in Auburn, Alabama last week, Clarke.
I think one of the big things, when you look at the stats, Jacksonville State had 161 yards rushing against Auburn. Fournette last week had 159 himself, 266 for LSU. If this Auburn defense can't stop the run against Jacksonville State, it's going to be really hard to stop Fournette.
He's going to rush for 400 yards.
Yeah, big implications of the SEC West title race for this game. An early game for a game of this implication. We'll talk about Alabama and Ole Miss later, but does the winner of this game, do you think they have the best shot to win the SEC West?
I think they have definitely the, upper hand.
Upper hand.
But, I think with Auburn's, you know, little fluke last week, I think it's going to be tough for them. You know, they drop in the rankings, you know, like 10 points in the rankings. And so that's not going to help them a lot. But I think, you know, this week's winner will have the definite, upper hand.
Reagan, let's talk about Auburn real quick. Jacksonville State last week took them to overtime and almost had them beat.
At home, too.
At home. So – What do you see out of this Auburn team? Are they just not that good? Were they overranked? Are they just not performing up to their standards? What's wrong with this team?
They were definitely overhyped. I mean, this is the team that everybody thought, okay, we'll probably make it to the SEC championship game and play a team like Tennessee or Missouri. But you come out and you're ranked so high and you almost blow it at home against a team that no one really knows about. And then, so, I mean, how do you turn that around? I mean, you have no confidence going in. If you're playing at home and you almost lose to a team like that and you go on the road to Death Valley where it's very tough to play, I mean, I'd be scared if I was an Auburn fan right now.
Yeah. Clarke, LSU is a national championship favorite by a lot of people to make the Final Four. Is this a must-win for them?
I think it is, especially because they're coming off a big win against Mississippi State last week. They need to be able to take that momentum into this game against Auburn, because once you start getting into the heart of the SEC West schedule, you got to be lucky that you're going to get two of these games out of the way early. I think if they win this game, I think it sets them up as a favorite. It'll be close between the Ole Miss-Alabama game, which we'll talk later, whoever wins that. I think between that game and this LSU-Auburn game, those two winners are going to be the front runners going forward.
All right, let's move on to number 14, Georgia Tech, versus number 8, Notre Dame. Both teams are undefeated. Notre Dame has a lot of injuries. Georgia Tech, the dark horse, coming out of nowhere, surprising a whole lot of people with that triple option attack. Georgia Tech is a 2.5-point favorite. What are you looking for out of this game, Reagan?
Well, Georgia Tech just gives teams fits. I mean, Notre Dame had so much hype coming in to last week before losing their starting quarterback, and now they have to go and play a team that's just putting up nothing but numbers. I mean, 69 points in the first game. If you're a linebacker for Notre Dame, I'd be just nervous to see who do you go for?
And
Notre Dame struggled against this type of offense. They play Navy every year, and Navy runs the same offense.
Yeah.
And they've given up 35-plus points the last couple years they played Navy, so it shows that their defense doesn't really know how to handle this type of offense.
Georgia Tech is leading the country in points scored per game. Clarke, if you're Notre Dame and you just lost your quarterback, Malik Zaire, it's probably going to be a shootout today. How do you recover from that?
I think the big thing is when you get Kaiser in the game, you just got to settle him down early. If they can get some points on the board quick, that's really going to put the pressure on Georgia Tech, because they're not good at passing. So if you can get ahead and make Georgia Tech play from behind, they're only averaging 104 yards per game through the air. You got to be able to get the ball in the air quick, get some points on the board, and make Georgia Tech have to try and play from behind and out of their comfort zone.
That's right. Carson, what do you see?
Yeah, I have one big stat for Georgia Tech. They have never beaten a top 10 Notre Dame squad. They are 0-10-1 all time.
Wow.
So today they are, they are severely underrated, I think. But I think they could possibly get it done today. I do.
You think they're going to get it done today? Who do you guys think wins the game today? Notre Dame or Georgia Tech?
In the end, I mean, even though Notre Dame's got some injuries, I think Notre Dame can pull it off.
I think Georgia Tech, this team is surprising. I mean, this is a sleeper team that in the ACC, which you don't know if the strength is as much because now that Jameis is gone, Florida State's not how they used to be, especially after last night.
Right.
And so, but Georgia Tech can put up points, and this may be a team that comes and has a chance to make it to the Final Four, so they have to win this game.
Yeah, to me, coming out of the ACC, it's either going to be Georgia Tech or my pick, Clemson.
But you have to win out if you're in the ACC.
No, exactly.
Georgia Tech's my dark horse to win the ACC, so I got Georgia Tech in this game as well.
Okay.
Let's move on and talk about the game. The big game tonight, Alabama and Ole Miss. Ole Miss at Alabama, having a tough time in Tuscaloosa. Alabama is a 7-point favorite at home. Clarke,
I think it's
does Ole Miss get the win?
You know, I don't think they do. Everyone's a little interested because Ole Miss is averaging over 70 points a game. And I think when you think of Ole Miss, you think of their tough defense, not them putting up 70 points. But they haven't gone against anybody. I think Alabama's defense, it's going to be one of the best in the nation. They have one of the best rushing defenses in the country, 12th in the nation right now. I think they're going to put up some points. But in Tuscaloosa, I don't think Ole Miss is going to come out with a win.
Reagan?
Ole Miss is 1-26 in Tuscaloosa.
Yeah, that's not good.
It's not a place you just go in and say, you know, we're going to win today and pull off a victory. But it's a new year. Alabama's not the typical high-scoring Alabama with this quarterback that's going to lead him, like the A.J. McCarrons. So there's a chance Ole Miss can go in there and knock him off. But like we said earlier, the winner of that game, like Clarke said, is a front runner in this who goes to the SEC championship game.
Yeah, I'm definitely, you know, right there with you. Alabama is going to have to rely on three freshman D-backs because of injury. You know, they've had, you know, just some bad luck this year so far. As far as injuries go.
Yeah.
So it's just going to be tough for them, I think. Ole Miss definitely can put up the points. So we're going to see today.
Is this a must-win for Alabama, guys? Because if they want to keep pace with LSU, I predict LSU getting the win today. So if they want to keep pace with LSU, they got to win today, don't they?
I think so. I mean, unless LSU loses, because the way Auburn's been playing, even if they were to beat LSU today, I would still see them possibly losing down the road. But it would be big for Alabama, because if they could get a game up on LSU, I think it's got to be the only way they really have a chance. If they lose and LSU wins, they really have to hope for that game later in the year, and that's just to get them even.
A lot of talk about SEC teams being highly ranked at the beginning of the season. A lot are going to start going down because they're starting to play each other, and it's the SEC. It's what they always do. They beat up on each other. Who do you think comes out of the SEC West alive, Reagan?
After this week or at the end of the
season?
After
this week.
Oh. If you look at just past and just as a program, Alabama.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't think they can lose today. And Nick Saban knows how to prepare his squad. You're playing at home. Yeah. But this is a game, Alabama. If they win, the momentum going forward is very high. But there's no clear favorite in the SEC West this year.
Yeah.
There's just so many teams that are so good. Even Auburn, who had a rough week last week. Who knows? That could have just been a complete fluke.
Yeah.
They win out, and now they're in the SEC championship game.
Alabama's a completely different team in Tuscaloosa. They prepare better. Yeah. They just seem to be an all-around way better team when they're in Tuscaloosa in front of those home fans at Bryant-Denny Stadium. So I got Alabama getting the win today.
Yeah.
All right, guys, let's move on. Talk about the darlings, the Hail Mary Mighty Fighting BYU Cougars. They are taking on number 10, UCLA, today. It's a big game for BYU. Two Hail Marys back-to-back weeks. Who wins this game today, Carson?
I'm going to have to go with UCLA. I think they are one of the most underrated teams in the country. They have a serious chance to win the college football playoff this year, I think. Their defense is so physical and so fast, they're going to give Tanner Mangum fits today.
Yeah, UCLA, 16.5-point favorite, Reagan.
Has the luck ran out? That's what I want to know. I mean, it's a battle of freshman quarterbacks. You have Josh Rosen, who's just lighting up the stats, putting up numbers. And you have a guy like Tanner Mangum who comes in and wins two games on last-second Hail Marys. I mean, can the luck stay going? So we'll see.
I mean, the Storm and Mormons, how do you pick against them, Clarke?
I think one of the big things is that it's not like they're coming into UCLA where they haven't played a game, they don't have any confidence. they've got two big wins under their belt. One was on the road at Nebraska, so I don't think they're going to be fazed going on the road at UCLA.
No.
And their defense right now is 13th in the nation in sacks per game. They're averaging 3.5. So if they can get some pressure on UCLA, that's really going to be a big key.
Yeah, Rose Bowl not really known as being one of the toughest places to play in college football. It's kind of like a neutral site, really, because those fans in LA aren't too harsh on people, and it doesn't seem like it's going to be
like
that tough of a road
of
a hostile environment for the BYU Cougars.
Yeah.
I like BYU to get the upset today. I think they're the darlings. I think they don't go undefeated or run the table or anything, but I think they surprise UCLA, catch them off guard a little bit, and get the win today. All right, let's move on. It was a tough week last week for my Hogs. They are now 1-1 after losing to Toledo in Little Rock last week. They're taking on a Texas Tech team that's undefeated, and they're in Fayetteville today. Do my Hogs get the win today, Clarke?
I think they do, and the big reason is Tech right now, they have the 92nd ranked pass defense. Arkansas is 12th.
Yeah.
And Tech hasn't been known for their defense in recent years. Last year they got run for like over 400 yards by Arkansas.
Yeah.
And when you look at it this year, the big surprising thing is that Arkansas is 89th in rushing offense.
Yeah.
That's not what you expect when you think of the Hogs and Coach Bielema. I think they're going to get back to their ground game today.
Yeah.
And being at home in Fayetteville, they know they got to show up after what happened last week. So I don't think Texas Tech's really going to put up too much of a fight late in the game.
Yeah, they're missing Jonathan Williams, that part of that two-headed monster in the backfield. A lot of weight being put on Alex Collins' shoulder, Reagan.
Yeah, I put a lot of hype on Arkansas this year, running the table and causing a lot of fits for those SEC West teams.
Yeah.
And then last week, we're just like, what happened?
Yeah.
And so, I mean, this game last year, when these two played each other, it was a battle.
Yeah,
so I'm excited to see how this turns out and see how SEC matches up with the Big 12 again.
Arkansas's got the big game in Jerry World next week against Texas A&M. Do you see them overlooking Texas Tech?
Maybe a little bit. You know, I think they're going to be very excited for that game next week. They could possibly come out, you know, slow, but we're going to see today. That's something that they kind of have to not overlook.
Yeah, Arkansas is an 11-point favorite here. I think they get the win today, but I think it's going to be closer than a lot of people think. Arkansas, like you said, just doesn't have Jonathan Williams in that backfield to help out Alex Collins. Brandon Allen did not have a good game last week against Toledo, and if Arkansas wants to throw the ball, Keon Hatcher needs to catch probably about 10 balls today for about 150 yards.
Well, I think a big key is Texas Tech is +5 in turnover margin through the first two games.
Yeah.
If they can take care of the ball and if they can force Arkansas to make some mistakes, that's really going to keep them in the game. And you never know if coming after the Toledo game, Arkansas might try and do too much, thinking they have to make up for everything.
Yeah. Reagan?
Yeah. Well, I mean, I was thinking about this. You said that Brandon Allen had a bad game. He's in the top 5 in passing in the nation.
Yeah.
He can put up numbers. So,
yeah, he can.
I mean, it may be his day today to put up the numbers and 500 yards passing, 4 touchdowns, and they knock off Texas Tech.
I'm right there with you. You know, I think that could definitely happen today.
I think Arkansas covers the spread, gets the win, probably by about 14 points today. Mm-hmm. All right, we're not done yet here on GamedayU. Coming up after the break, we'll talk about our top stories from around the nation so far. This is GamedayU presented by Hebert Financial. Stay with us.
Hebert Financial Services is a full-service, family-owned business that offers comprehensive financial planning. They work hard to design strategies to help you reach your financial goals.
Having a full-service, holistic financial planning firm, it's evolved to estate planning attorneys, CPAs, financial planners.
They assist with wills, trusts, asset protection, and much more. It's really about understanding what people are going through as they enter new stages in their life. With over 25 years of experience, Hebert Financial Services can help you reach your financial goals.
Welcome back to GamedayU, powered by Hebert Financial, here with Carson Williams, Reagan Ledbetter, and Clarke Sacks. Guys, let's talk about some of the biggest stories so far in the nation. Jerod Hurd is now the quarterback of the Texas Longhorns. What do you see out of him, Clarke?
I think it's impressive. When you look at last game, he was effective without having to do too much. He was only 4 of 7 for 120 yards, but he finally brought what we thought Swoops was going to bring, a rushing game. 10 carries for 96 yards, and, you know, it wasn't the most spectacular game, but it was something that obviously really made a difference in this offense. It got the team going, and they put up 48 points after, you know, only getting 3 a week ago. This guy, Jerod Hurd, I think he's really going to help turn this team around.
Okay, Reagan, does Texas need Jerod Hurd, or did Texas just need change?
Change for sure. I don't.
Yeah.
Oh, that's without a doubt. I mean,
Strong
changed the coaches, put Jay Norvell in charge of the play
exactly,
calls.
Yeah.
I don't think it mattered who was the guy. They needed someone else because Longhorn Nation's so down, and so it was cool. That, I mean, college football's great when Texas is playing well. No matter how much you love them or hate them, it's college football's good when they're playing well. And so when Longhorn Nation was down, Jerod Hurd comes in, and his first touchdown is a 53-yard rush touchdown, something that Texas lacked, which was a rushing quarterback.
Yeah.
So I mean, it'll be interesting to see.
That burnt orange that's glowing from the dumpster fire, that is the Texas Longhorns. Wow. It's just not looking good right now, Carson.
It's not. You know, they've been kind of inconsistent for the past couple years. It's only been a couple years since they were, you know, in the national championship.
Yeah.
And so they've kind of gotten away from what they're used to running. You know, Mac Brown's gone. He's not coming back. He even said, he's not interested in the new athletic director job. Yeah. So, you know, he's not coming walking through those doors anytime soon. So they're going to have to figure it out on their own.
Yeah, something we haven't talked about yet is the athletic director is gone. He's out, Clarke.
Yeah, and I think a lot of people were saying, oh, is that a bad sign for Charlie Strong? Because he's the one that hired Charlie Strong. Yeah. You bring in a new athletic director who maybe wants to kind of clear house and get his own coaches. But I think Charlie Strong's still going to get his time. I think when they bring in a new guy that, you know, lets the system work itself out, especially if Gerard Hurd keeps playing well. If things start to turn around now, then Charlie Strong doesn't have anything to worry about regardless of who comes in to replace Patterson.
We're a pro-Charlie Strong panel, right?
Oh, yeah.
For keeping his job.
I'm tired of hearing about how they should just – he's on the hot seat. He's been there for, what, 2 years?
Yeah. This is his second year.
I mean, how do you turn a program from being completely mediocre into greatness, national championship, not only because it's hard, but because you have teams in your in the Big 12 that are tough to beat. You can't just put the guy on the hot seat just because he's having some rough games.
It's just something we have to talk about, though. You know, all those people down in Austin, they want change and they want it.
They want it now. They are
not willing to wait for it.
It's just human nature. I mean, we're in Norman and everybody wants to fire Bob Stoops when he's just had his 100th consecutive sellout today.
Yeah. I mean, and I think those OU fans need to take a look at what's happened with Texas, where that, you know, Mac Brown, he wasn't fired. He was kind of pushed out. He retired. Yeah. Was kind of forced.
Yeah, retired.
But you look at what's happened where you bring in a new coach, it takes time, and they're falling off right now. And I think OU fans need to look at Texas as an example that things could be a lot worse.
Yeah, right.
We could be Texas.
It's funny how you said that all the Texas fans are calling for Mac Brown to come back as the athletic director. Mac Brown's the reason you're in this position in the first place. Yeah. He's the one who couldn't get the recruits in. He's the one who left left this mess for Charlie Strong to pick up. It's just Charlie Strong is the coach of this Texas Longhorns team and will be. I am just certain that this team will come back. They're the Texas Longhorns. They can't be awful forever. They're like Notre Dame. They aren't going to be bad forever. Brian Kelly came in and made the Notre Dame Fighting Irish relevant again. So I think Charlie Strong can do the same type
of thing. I think there's more to it than Charlie Strong being able to recruit. It's Texas as a whole. There's so many teams that are good now. You have Baylor, you have TCU. Guys want to go play for A&M because they're in the SEC West. They want to play Bama. They want to play Auburn. They want to play LSU. And so Texas, who was this powerhouse recruiting program, is now struggling to get these top guys because they all want to go play somewhere else.
Exactly.
And no matter if Texas was good or not, there's still those other options that guys want to go play for.
Exactly. I mean, they want to go play for offenses that, you know, can
put up numbers.
Exactly. I mean, and that's not in Austin.
It's hard to have a winning program when that's the case. I mean, Oklahoma's fortunate that they only have them in Oklahoma State.
Yeah.
So they have to battle with them, and they get a lot of Texas players. But Texas, who basically dominated all of the recruits, is now struggling to find those top guys. They're having to settle with three-star athletes.
Right.
Let's move on. Notre Dame takes on Georgia Tech today in a tough, tough matchup. Notre Dame ridden with injuries, including their starting quarterback, Malik Zaire. Guys, what is the biggest injury for this Notre Dame team, Carson?
To me, I think it's going to be Malik Zaire.
Yeah.
Whenever you lose your starting quarterback, your entire team just kind of
feels deflated.
Your
starting quarterback who was balling out.
Yeah.
He was balling out.
Yeah, and, you know, they have four starters, five big-time contributors that are all out for the year. How can you handle that?
How do you recover, Reagan?
Well, I think the biggest key is Malik Zaire. I mean,
yeah.
You come into this season, and your first game of the year, you just completely whoop up on Texas Tech. The excitement,
you're looking good.
The excitement is high in South Bend. And then all of a sudden you lose your starting quarterback on a kind of a fluke play, out for the season. Then you have this young guy come in and still winning the game. But how much confidence can you have in your football program and your team as a fan when this guy that was just putting up massive numbers is now out?
Besides Malik Zaire, who's the biggest injury?
I think the biggest injury is their tight end, Durham Smythe, who they also lost last week. Because whenever you have a new quarterback coming in, you want to have these guys that are big-time weapons that you can use. They already lost their starting running back week one. I think if they had a guy like Durham Smythe, who was the senior, they've only got freshmen and sophomores at tight end now. He was going to be a big key. He could help their new quarterback Kizer settle in and really kind of help run through this offense, because their backup running back, he only had like 200 yards rushing last year. He's being thrown to a big spot now. I think if they could keep Durham Smythe, it would have been a big weapon for the new quarterback coming in.
Notre Dame was a favorite to make the college football playoff at the beginning of the season. How many wins do you see for this team now, Carson?
I'm going to say 9.
Yeah.
I think they're still going to be a very good football team, but I think with all these injuries, it's going to be tough for them to kind of run the table.
We'll say over, under 8.5 wins.
Over. I say over. I think they can get 10. But for a team like Notre Dame, getting 10 wins is a big deal, because they don't play this conference schedule where they have to play fluke teams.
Yeah.
They
right.
play nothing but mostly good opponents the entire year from every conference.
Yeah,
I would go over. I agree with Carson. I would say 9 wins. I think once you give them time to, you know, kind of get all these new guys in their position, they can still be a good team. I mean, we saw Ohio State. They didn't get bothered by having one or two quarterbacks go down, so it's possible.
I'm gonna go under. I think they get 8 wins. I think it's going to be a tough season for the Notre Dame Fighting Irish, especially today. I think Georgia Tech goes into South Bend and beats them today, so it's not looking good for the Notre Dame Fighting Irish. All right, moving on. Jim Harbaugh wins his first game as a Michigan Wolverine. Go Blue, right? Am I right, guys? He got his first win last week. Is the Jim Harbaugh era officially begun? Clark.
I think there's still some time we got to wait for. Oregon State's only win coming to the game was against Weber State. I'm not going to put too much on the Oregon State win. But it's better. They did put up 35 points. Their defense looked a whole lot better. They forced a lot of turnovers. They gave them short fields. Some of their scoring possessions were 33 yards, 3 yards, and 39 yards for the Michigan offense. They finally got a nice run game down, but their quarterback is still, he went 18 for 26, 180 yards, no touchdowns, one interception. I think there's still a long way to go.
Yeah, to be fair, though, Jim Harbaugh got this win against a Pac-12 team. It's not like he was playing an independent or, you know, a Jacksonville State like Auburn.
Yeah.
Like they played a quality opponent in Oregon State.
No, it was important, not only the win, but like I said in past weeks, to fill that stadium back up.
Right.
Michigan's a powerhouse. They're a top team year in and year out. They're supposed to be. And when you have 110,000 seats in that stadium and you bring this new coach in, his number one job should have been to fill in that stadium. And they've done that.
Yeah.
So this could bring momentum for this program. But I think you're not going to really figure out how the Jim Harbaugh era is going to go until maybe a season and a half – into his tenure to figure out how they're going to be.
Yeah.
You know, last week they got back to their run game, which is kind of what they've been known for.
Yeah.
You know, they had 225 yards on 48 carries. All those runs ate up 38 minutes of clock time. That's how they got the win, I think. You know, they ate up so much clock, just dominated offensively, and were able to get Jim Harbaugh his first win.
Yeah, Jim Harbaugh loves to run the ball. He showed that in San Francisco with Frank Gore. He ran it all the time. So now you start to see Harbaugh implement a system. Let's see if he can get a little momentum coming up. The Ohio State game at the end of the season, maybe that could be a little closer than we thought. Who knows? I'm not giving Michigan all the praise right now. I don't think they're going to run the table and win the Big Ten or anything.
But that could be a big game.
It could.
That could totally boost him as a coach and the program if they could somehow knock off Ohio State.
Oh, yeah.
So we'll see.
I think it's important to us. I mean, yes, I was saying it's Oregon State. It's not a big win. But the big thing is that he got the win that he needs. You got to make sure that you are winning these games you're expected
first
to win.
Yeah.
And this week they're playing UNLV, who's 0-2. You got to get a win like that, because after that it's BYU, who, you know, we're going to see tonight what they're really about. And so you got to make sure that you get these wins that your team should be getting. And then you hope for an upset later in the year to really build momentum.
Yeah. All right, let's move on. OU got the win last week versus Tennessee, a very good SEC team, probably one of the favorites to win the SEC East besides Missouri. Paul Feinbaum on College Game Day last week had a little call out for the University of Oklahoma, saying OU football isn't relevant anymore. Bob Stoops said in his press conference on Monday that asked the 105,000 fans in Knoxville, Tennessee, if OU is irrelevant anymore. Guys?
I mean, I think he says that OU is irrelevant, yet every time there's talk with SEC and Big 12, it's not really SEC and Big 12. It's SEC and OU.
Yeah.
So how are you going to say that they're irrelevant when you're still finding reasons to bring them up? And this year it was Stryker who said something. Stoops had kept his mouth shut.
Oh, yeah.
So why are you saying OU is irrelevant? Because there was no reason to even bring that comment out there.
Right.
But, I mean, it's Paul Feinbaum, and I could say a lot more, but I'll leave it at that.
Yeah, I mean, Feinbaum was one who said that OU – like many commentators said, OU was going to roll in to the Sugar Bowl and just get bowled over by Alabama a couple years ago. And now they have this big-time win on the road against Tennessee. OU's not afraid of the SEC,
no.
Reagan.
First off, Paul Feinbaum is irrelevant. Is irrelevant.
He had to put on the OU hat the next day.
He put on the OU hat.
Come on, Paul.
This guy, I swear, you totally just bash on this program. I can see why when they're playing. What's funny to me is how Paul Feinbaum can bash Oklahoma against the SEC when OU just for some reason excels against them, but then they choke against teams on their own conference.
Yeah.
Or these
Hebert Financial Services is a full service family owned business to offer
success over there.
Maybe Paul should just start bashing on OU when they're playing Tulsa and then they'll just beat them by 60 points. Yeah. But I think last week's win really just shoved it in Paul Feinbaum's face. I mean, that was a game. I mean, it was pretty. It was beautiful.
Yeah.
You go into a stadium like that where you can't even think straight because it's so loud, and they knock off. That was the biggest game in Tennessee in probably 30 years.
Yeah.
Yeah, we'll talk about it a little later, but that game was big time for the Sooners.
I still can't get over it.
They've got three straight wins against the SEC now. Two of which were on the road.
Yes.
So that's, I mean, you can't call OU irrelevant when they've got three straight wins against the SEC.
Yeah.
One of which was against Alabama in the Sugar Bowl, which no one thought they had a chance in.
What does OU have to do to get this SEC monkey off of their back? Do they have to win 10 in a row?
Win a national title?
Yeah, I think
I'm going to have to say that.
I think if they go into a bowl game this year against an SEC team and if they can win, regardless if it's convincingly or if it's a narrow win, if they win against an SEC in a bowl game this year, I think that finally has to kind of dispel this OU and SEC talk, because if they can go four straight games with wins against SEC, there's no reason to keep talking about it.
Well, they're going to end up doing it. Like, they're going to keep talking about
it. People bring up Florida State and how they won the national championship, you know, took that away from the SEC. OU beat them a couple years ago in Tallahassee.
Yeah.
They went
and
on the road.
And then beat them by, 35 here?
Yeah, and beat them the year before right behind us in Gaylord Family Oklahoma Memorial Stadium.
Yeah.
Like, it's unbelievable to me that this conversation is still even happening when OU –
The problem is it just causes it leads to ratings, and people like to hear.
Well, that's what Feinbaum's there for.
That's what he's there for. That's why he gets paid. Well, we don't get paid, but we're coming right back here on GamedayU, powered by Hebert Financial. Stick with us.
Hebert Financial Services is a full-service, family-owned business that offers comprehensive financial planning. They work hard to design strategies to help you reach your financial goals.
Having a full-service, holistic financial planning firm, it's evolved to estate planning attorneys, CPAs, financial planners.
They assist with wills, trusts, asset protection, and much more. It's really about understanding what people are going through as they enter new stages in their life. With over 25 years of experience, Hebert Financial Services can help you reach your financial goals.
Welcome back to GamedayU, powered by Hebert Financial. It's the game that's sweeping the nation, well, sweeping our nation. It is four downs where I ask the panel four questions, and they give me their best answer. I'll start with this first question. Which team concerns you the most? Is it Baylor or Auburn? Auburn had a tough game last week against Jacksonville State, as we already talked about, and Baylor just hasn't looked up to Baylor standards so far this season. Clark?
For me, it's Baylor, because a lot of people, after their success last year, they thought Baylor might be one of the top two teams that could potentially make the Final Four. Auburn, I was still a little kind of weary on. But the thing is, against SMU and Lamar, this Baylor defense is averaging 26 points to those two teams. And you talk about Lamar, they gave up 31. It's one of those things where it just doesn't make any sense. They're supposed to be one of the top teams, and I know everyone wants to talk about their offense, but they're giving up almost 360 yards per game to SMU and Lamar. Think about what's going to happen when they go play against TCU or something.
Yeah, Reagan?
You know, I agree with that, but I think it really comes down to being Auburn. Yeah. They're in a much harder division. I know everybody says the SEC is overhyped, whatever. Yeah. But, I mean, they really are. They play tougher teams week to week.
Yeah.
Baylor has Oklahoma and TCU, but they also have a kind of mediocre schedule in Big 12 play. So if you're Auburn and you're struggling against a team like Jacksonville State, that just shows your season is going down the drain fast.
Yeah.
Carson?
I'm gonna have to, you know, go with Reagan here. Auburn has lost their identity on offense. Jeremy Johnson has not lived up to his expectations, and, you know, at least Baylor has their identity. They're going to score their points. You know, they're going to get their 60. Yeah, their defense isn't great, but whenever you score 60 a game, that's what you bank on. So I think, I think it's Auburn.
You think it's Auburn?
Yeah.
I don't think Auburn's going to win the SEC West, so I'm not really concerned with them. They're going to lose a couple games and not be relevant in the SEC West at the end of the season. For me, it's Baylor. You were picked to win the conference.
Yeah.
Like, by a lot of people. And you go out there and you struggle against SMU and Lamar, That doesn't look good for you. And like you said, their defense is just not looking very good.
90th in rushing defense. Like, yeah. That's going to get you beat against a lot of teams if you can't stop the team from – I mean, that's the only reason OU was in game last year is because the one thing they could do is run the ball.
Yeah,
you can run the ball, you can control the clock.
You're, and telling, if, me, you're telling me the you're 90th in the nation in rush defense, and I got Samaje Perine and Joe Mixon in the backfield, and I'm Bob Stoops, and I got the NCAA leading rusher from last year.
And we got a line that might be struggling, but the line's better than Lamar.
Well, you're 90th, and you've only played SMU and Lamar.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
It's
everybody knew that, you know, Baylor's defense isn't good. Like, that's a well-known fact.
Yeah, but
if there's
two games they should be good for, it's those two.
Yeah, no, you're right.
But, I mean, the thing with Baylor, though, is for some reason America loves them. Auburn almost loses to Jacksonville State, who I've actually heard of, and they dropped six spots.
Yeah, Baylor heard of Lamar?
Puts up what? Gives up.
You don't know who Lamar is?
No. I didn't know who Lamar was. I didn't know who Lamar was. Yeah, I didn't. I had
give
no
up
idea.
30 points to Lamar, who? And
he must be
let's
pretty
keep
good.
Top ranked.
Yeah, let's keep him up there. Well, I mean, you look at it. Baylor can't stop the run, and if I'm OU, I'm looking at them and saying, "Give me Baylor.
Yeah.
Give him to me, because if I'm Bob Stoops
right now,
I can run the football.
Yeah.
And I'll be all right with that. Like, give me Samaje Perine versus that defense any day. And give me Joe Mixon.
The only threat Baylor's got right now is Coleman.
And
we've
Corey
seen
Coleman
how we've seen how this, I mean, he's what the leading receiver in the nation right now. And OU is the best right now in the secondary, believe it or not.
Yeah.
And so OU wants to play him right now, maybe this week. Just switch games up.
I know.
Baylor comes up here, get the game over with.
Yeah. All right. Moving on. Question number two. Michigan State got a big win last week against Oregon. Oregon was ranked inside the top 10, and Michigan State let them come into East Lansing. They whooped up on them. Can Michigan State win the Big Ten? Carson.
I think they can. I don't think it's going to happen, but I think that they're very capable of doing it. You know, I think Ohio State right now is just on another level. I think that they are much better now than they were when they won it all last year. You know, you have Ezekiel Elliott, Braxton Miller at wide receiver, you know, Cardale Jones, just so many weapons on offense that they can go to. I don't think Michigan State can keep up with it. But I think they have a decent chance at making it to the playoff.
I think Michigan State can win the Big Ten. What do you think, Reagan?
You know, I think they can win, like you said, but I don't know if it'll happen.
Right.
Well, Ohio State, they're probably the best team in the nation right now, but they aren't as electrifying as I predicted this season. And they only put up, 38 against Hawaii last week at home in their home opener. So it's like, okay, are they all there? Are they clicking on all cylinders or not? But at Michigan State, it's a very good program. The only problem with that is they actually have to go into Columbus this year. If the game was in East Lansing, the chances are a lot higher that Michigan State wins that. If whoever wins that game is going to be the Big Ten champion for
sure. You don't think they could get two in?
What?
You don't think, you know, the Big Ten could get both Michigan State and Ohio State in?
After last year with the Big 12 not getting one in when they could have potentially had two in, I feel like the committee's going to be really – really eerie about putting in two teams from one conference.
When you have a conference like the SEC that is so recognized, it's almost impossible to see two teams from the same conference.
But at the same time, you know, they've been preaching since they, you know, started this college football playoff, they're looking for the four best teams.
But I wish they did that.
You know, you're right. But I think they're going to have to, you know,
take some years last year
to kind of, you know, get that. I think it's just, you're right. It's just going to be hard for them to you know, give two teams out of one conference.
The chances are better this year, because I don't think there's going to be one team from the Pac-12 that's going to make it.
The ACC might not make it.
Oregon, no.
I feel like
if anything
is the ACC, but I mean, Georgia Tech, Clemson is going to be really interesting to see what happens there. That's where the key is for the ACC.
Right. Clark, does Michigan State lose a game until they play Ohio State?
I don't think they do, unless they're just extremely upset by someone. The big problem is that Connor Cook, he's only completing 56% of his passes.
Yeah, that's not
very
good.
They've got a good run game, but you're not going to be able to be one-dimensional once the season gets deeper. I mean, Oregon, you know, they did hold them to 28 points. They forced two interceptions. Their defense is still really good. That's what Michigan State's known for.
Yeah.
But I think they go undefeated until Ohio State, unless something happens, and it's just one of those weeks where upsets are bound to happen.
Yeah. Connor Cook's got to show up if he wants this Michigan State team to get a chance to get a Big Ten championship. All right, guys. BYU, the darlings that we already talked about, have won two straight games thanks to two Hail Marys with a backup quarterback. Is BYU a pretender or a contender? Carson.
I'm going to say they're a pretender. the, you know, two straight Hail Mary wins, that luck has to run out sooner or later.
Yeah.
You know, today they have UCLA, a tough, very tough task. And the next week doesn't really get much easier. They go to Michigan.
Yeah.
Jim Harbaugh is going to be fired up for that game, especially if they can pull out the win against UCLA. I don't think that they're going to make it.
We talked last
through.
Week about cream puff scheduling. BYU is the exact opposite.
Oh, they're taking on they have one of the they have one of the toughest
Notre
schedules.
Game, they're an independent, so they kind of have the freedom to go schedule whoever they want. And if you want to be in the mix at the end of the year as an independent, you have to go out and schedule some of these big games.
Right. Yeah.
To me, they're a contender for that reason right there. I mean, they're playing UCLA, Michigan, at Nebraska. That just shows that this program is serious about trying to make a name for themselves.
Yeah, but can they get? Can they, you know, make it through that schedule?
Look, I don't think they can make it to the Final Four. Oh, but like the New Year's Six,
of course not.
One of those bowl games.
I don't think they're going to be playing against Memphis like they were last year. I think this is a team that they've got some of the big games in there, but they also have some easier games. They don't really play anyone after Michigan up until Missouri in November. That. They're going to have those easy wins. They're going to be probably a 10-win team because they have some games in there that they can kind of take off an independent.
The problem is they've won these two games off pretty much luck. And that luck, until we see them put up 50 points on a team, if they go into UCLA today and put up 50 points or 40 points and win convincingly, okay, ask us again next week and I'll answer that question. But you can't really answer that based off of two Hail Marys.
Yeah, they've just been bailed out.
It's funny you say that, a win is a win, because let's look at last year. And I'm not saying they're the same team as Florida State or as talented, but Florida State last year
got tested by pretty much
everybody and got taken to the wire by pretty much everybody. Yeah. BYU, a win's a win at the end of the day, and if they can just rattle off a few wins, get 10-win season, I don't see why you can't put them in one of the New Year's Six Bowls.
Right.
Like, they...
But we knew Florida State was good last year.
We
knew that Jameis struggled. His first half woes, throwing picks. But we knew Florida State was a good team. Their defense was stout. BYU, I think they're good, and I'm very impressed. But I want to see this team win convincingly against a top team. If they can beat Michigan, even if they lose this week, it's very possible. UCLA is kind of on fire right now. But if they can go beat Michigan... This team's on an upward spiral, and it's looking promising.
I would switch it because, I'm not too sold on Michigan yet. I think if you beat Michigan, well, congrats, you just beat Michigan.
Yeah.
But, I mean, it'll be interesting to see. I think this week is where we really find out pretender or contender.
I think it all comes down to me. I think it all comes down to Tanner Mangum because he's going to have to carry that team. You know, he's going to have to be
– He should buy a lotto ticket right now.
No, he's on fire right now. Man. He's going to have to, you know, play like that for the entire game against UCLA.
What does BYU have to do – for you to be convinced that they're a contender to the guys who said they were pretenders?
I think they have to win today. You know, if they can win against a big-time UCLA team, like, you know, Reagan said, they're on fire right now, I think that is a massive statement.
If they can win on the road at UCLA, this shows that this program is for real. They're not just winning off of just luck.
Yeah.
I think a win today, I don't care if it's another Hail Mary. If it's a win, it's a win.
Tanner Mangum in the Heisman contention.
It's a win. I like Clarke Sachs. A win is a win. All right, now on to question number four. After two slow starts, the OU offense that was supposed to be electrifying has looked anything but, really. Two slow starts in the first half has just not really helped out the Sooners all that much. The defense saved the day last week against Tennessee, and Baker Mayfield said all those slow starts are on us. It's not anything that the defense is doing that's surprising us. We just aren't performing up to our potential. Do you see another slow start out of OU today? Reagan, we'll start with you.
I hope so. I'm tired of sitting there for an hour and a half trying to wait to watch football after the game's already started. I mean, it's pathetic. But I think of all games, today's the day where they're going to come out firing on all cylinders. After that win last week, there's so much hype on this team.
Yeah.
So much hype for Sooner Nation. Norman, this place is going to be rocking today. I mean, it doesn't matter who they're playing. They're playing Tulsa, which is a good program this year, but this is a game that Baker's going to come out and probably put up three touchdowns in the first quarter.
Wow.
Carson?
I actually do think that they're going to have a slow start. I think it all comes down to the offensive line. The offensive line, I think, is struggling mightily right now. Orlando Brown has not been as good as he was, you know, hyped to be. Ty Darlington is banged up a little bit. So you're going to have a bunch of inexperienced guys on the offensive line today. And I think, you know, Tulsa's defensive line could give OU you know, some trouble today.
Clarke, another slow start?
I think there's going to be a slow start, but I don't think it's anything to really worry about. I just think it's going to be trying to get back into it after a huge win last week. And then you've got Neela and Ty Darlington, who are not going to be 100% with this O-line that's already struggled. I think it's just going to take them some time. I don't think it's a slow start that's going to worry anybody. I just think it might be the first few drives. It takes a while to really get a first down or get the ball rolling. But I think they're going to, after the first quarter, I think this offense will be fine.
How slow does the start have to be considered a slow start? I guess that's a weird question, but like, do they not have to, is it not scoring in the first quarter? Is it having 3 points at halftime? What is it?
I would say if you punt five times in your first like eight drives like they did against Akron, then I'd be concerned, because this is a high-powered Tulsa offense. So I think if your offense isn't going to be able to keep up with them, if you're punting five times in your first eight possessions like you were against Akron, then I think it's a problem.
We'll talk about this. We'll break down this game in hour number two, but you can't have a slow start today against Tulsa. Tulsa's a high-powered offense.
Yeah.
600 yards.
A game.
Powered offense. And Mike Stoops recognizes that. And, Mike Stoops isn't going to say it, but he needs some help from his offense. Guys, we're done with four downs. Hopefully OU doesn't have a slow start today, but I think we might see another one. But we're coming back right after this break. It's GamedayU, powered by Hebert Financial.
Hebert Financial Services is a full-service, family-owned business that offers comprehensive financial planning. They work hard to design strategies to help you reach your financial goals.
Having a full-service, holistic financial planning firm, it's evolved to estate planning attorneys, CPAs, financial planners.
They assist with wills, trusts, asset protection, and much more. It's really about understanding what people are going through as they enter new stages in their life. With over 25 years of experience, Hebert Financial Services can help you reach your financial goals.
Welcome back to GamedayU, powered by Hebert Financial. We're here in Norman, Oklahoma. Carson Williams, Reagan Ledbetter, Clarke Sacks with me as always. It's now time for a segment called Bold Predictions, where we give you a bold prediction about this Saturday's round of games. We'll start with you first, Carson. Give me your bold prediction.
Okay, I'm going to go Georgia Tech, Notre Dame. I think,
The Roughnecks are ready.
The Roughnecks are ready.
We're already ready for game day. Okay, I'm going to say Georgia Tech runs over Notre Dame. I think they're
no
a very impressive team this year in the ACC. I don't have them winning the ACC. I have Clemson, but I think Georgia Tech is a very good team. I think today they win by at least two touchdowns.
Let's talk about that real quick. Georgia Tech is a very good football team, as we've already seen. They run the ball very well, and they've thrown it pretty well so far this season. They haven't really played anybody, granted, but they're looking like a good team, Clarke.
I think it's the big thing. It's that triple option that we talked about, I believe, 2 weeks ago, where no one else is going to run the triple option. You've got 1 week to prepare for that triple option, and they run it to perfection.
Yeah.
And it's one of those things where, because you got three guys, you don't know who to key on, and they can pull it down where if you think they're going to sell it for the run, and they'll get you with one guy running downfield, and they do have a sneaky pass attack, which is going to be a big key to this game.
Yeah. Reagan?
See, Notre Dame may run over that Georgia Tech defense, but I think the Georgia Tech offense is going to run over the Notre Dame defense.
Yeah.
So it's just the question is who can score more points. But I think we can't really predict that because we don't know how Kaiser's going to play.
Right.
He could put up 50 points, 400 passing yards, and be a Heisman candidate. Who knows? But I think it's very possible that Notre Dame can go in there or play at home and run over him.
On paper, if it's going to be a shootout, it favors Georgia Tech. But as we all know, football isn't won on paper.
No.
So it's really dependent on what happens with Notre Dame's quarterback, Kaiser. He's got to play really good today. But I think Georgia Tech, like you already said, gets this win.
Yeah.
I don't think they roll over him. I think it's close in South Bend, and I think they still get out of there with the win, remain undefeated. All right, Clarke.
Oh. Sorry, Reagan.
Clarke and Reagan, you guys have the same one.
Well, let's remember last week my bold prediction was correct.
It was correct.
Hurt, so
it was correct.
This week I'm going to go with BYU goes on the road at UCLA and gets the upset. They ride that Mangum wave of momentum into California and come out with a win, and then they show to us that they're a contender. And it's going to be a really good season going forward watching BYU.
Reagan?
That was really good. My bold prediction is a little different.
Okay.
BYU goes into UCLA and wins. Oh, wait. It's the same.
Same thing.
You guys playing that?
It's the same thing.
Yeah. He's just trying to ride off my wave of last week.
He's jumping on the Clarke Sachs bandwagon like everyone should, really.
But I think out of everyone else, he's got the best bold prediction besides myself.
Thanks, Clarke. But I think the Storming Mormons, as Mason said earlier in the show, the luck continues. Three in a row, knock off UCLA, the team's contender. Here we go. It's football time in BYU.
BYU gets the win, I think. They're looking like a really good football team. A team of destiny is what we should say, because they're –
Well, they have no pressure on them.
They got God on their side. Yeah. Over there. They do. They're a great football team.
Look at their first three games. You know, they've got Nebraska, Boise State, and UCLA. That's a tough non-conference.
Yes.
They're not in a conference after. Yeah. Like, you know, when you're an independent, you can do those kind of things. But they scheduled really tough games this year.
Well, part of the reason why I picked BYU is I'm not sold on UCLA. Yeah. They're a team that, for whatever reason, I mean, they just lost Huntley, who's a really good quarterback, replacing a quarterback for them. I'm just not sold on him yet.
There's always that one team in the pack. Someone has to be hyped. Yeah. And this year it's UCLA. And every year we see the same story, that same team's hype. They get knocked off by a team in their division, and then they still get a chance to go play in a big game and end up losing.
Maybe if Snoop Dogg's son was still there, it'd boost their street cred, and I'd
have a little
more faith in
probably,
them.
That's true. Probably would. They're busy shooting Adidas commercials.
Yeah.
Snoop Dogg just posted up in Adidas commercials. But BYU, let's think about this. BYU played a Nebraska team. The jury's still out. We don't know how good Nebraska's going to be for the rest of the year. But Boise State is a good team. The week before beat Washington in a really close game and their former coach. So Boise State is a pretty good team. And
Oklahoma
knows that Boise State's a pretty good team. They're a pretty good program. So BYU, for me, has every ability to run the table and cause a whole lot of problems for a whole lot of people. So BYU, like we already said, gets the win today, in my opinion. So I will now move on to my bold prediction. I know everyone was waiting for it.
Arkansas wins today.
No.
What's new? Whoa.
That's not bold. They're 11-point favorite. That's not a bold prediction. My bold prediction is that Ole Miss gets dominated by Alabama today in Tuscaloosa. Not even close. I'm saying by at least 3 touchdowns, Alabama wins this game. I'm just not impressed with Ole Miss. I don't know what the big hype is around them. Maybe just because they're in the SEC West and they had a good season last year. But Alabama's just a far better football team than this Ole Miss. Am I wrong, Carson?
No, you're not wrong, because I think Alabama is still very mad about what happened last year. Ole Miss went in and beat Alabama, and I think the Crimson Tide are looking for a serious revenge game today, and I think it's going to happen. I think you're right.
There's nothing more terrifying than an angry Nick Saban team.
Oh yeah.
Is there, Reagan?
There's really not. I mean, other than Urban Meyer, he's the best coach in college football.
Yeah. Right.
It's Alabama. When you think of Alabama, you think of crazy fans and physical football.
Yeah.
And Ole Miss hasn't played a team that's physical yet. They won last year, but it wasn't like they beat them by 40 points.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter who's playing for Alabama. It doesn't matter who the quarterback is. It doesn't matter who's running the ball. Alabama's a good program.
No, yeah.
They know how to win games, and especially at home.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter if they're 1-1 right now.
Yeah.
This is a game they'll just win because they're at home.
The old Barry Switzer saying, hang half a hundred on them. Well, Alabama might hang half a hundred on them. I don't think Alabama quits today. If they get up big, I think Nick Saban doesn't call off the dogs.
They're going for 100.
Do you have a score prediction for the game then?
Do I have a score prediction?
For you, you personally.
50. I got 49-28.
Oh, but see, now you're just disappointing Barry Switzer.
Yeah. I know.
49?
Well, you missed 49. It by 1 point.
Over under 49.5 points.
I'm going
you pick
under.
49.
You're going under.
I'm going under.
You're going under.
I'm going under. 49.
49. All right. Reagan.
I'm going under.
You're going under.
49?
So we all have Alabama.
I have Alabama winning. Okay. I don't know if I think it's going to be a 3-touchdown win at the end of the day, but I do think Alabama comes out and wins.
Ole Miss has one thing on their side. They're wearing the throwbacks they wore, and the only time they've ever won in Tuscaloosa today. They're hideous.
That's right.
They're like a powder blue helmet with like gray pants.
Shout out to Archie Manning back in the day.
Yeah,
I guess.
Shout out to Archie Manning.
I mean, I guess that may win them the game, but we'll see.
Who knows? I mean, we already talked about this. Alabama probably needs this game to survive in the SEC West because they still got LSU to play. They still got A&M. They have a whole lot of tough games. But if I am right and Alabama gets up early, I don't see Nick Saban calling off the dogs, but do you think he tries to reserve his team, tries to save some guys? Because, I mean, it's a tough SEC schedule. You could get some guys hurt.
Not a chance.
Yeah. I mean, I think you still wait until around the fourth quarter before you really pull anything in. Because you don't want to give a team that like Ole Miss, who's putting up 70 points a game, You don't want to just say, all right, let's put it on cruise control, because then that's when things can turn really fast.
Yeah, I think so.
It's a rivalry. I mean, I don't think you can, at any point, you can just say, you know what, we're just going to take our starters out, no matter how much we're up, and just win. I mean, this is the game you want to beat them down.
Yeah.
It, with this new system for playoff, you can't do that anymore, because you have to win convincingly, and no matter how much you're up, you need to get the attention of the voters.
Exactly.
You're absolutely right.
I'm definitely right there with you. I think so.
Here's a bold Carson prediction. This segment is over. We are now moving on to the second hour. When we come back, it's Game Day U, powered by Hebert Financial. I'm here with Carson Williams, Reagan Ledbetter, Clarke Sachs. We're talking OU and Tulsa coming up next in hour number two. All hour number two. Stay with us. We're here in Norman, right outside Gaylord Family Oklahoma Memorial Stadium.
Hebert Financial Services is a full-service, family-owned business that offers comprehensive financial planning. They work hard to design strategies to help you reach your financial goals.
Having a full-service, holistic financial planning firm, it's evolved to estate planning attorneys, CPAs, financial planners.
They assist with wills, trusts, asset protection, and much more. It's really about understanding what people are going through as they enter new stages in their life. With over 25 years of experience, Hebert Financial Services can help you reach your financial goals.
Welcome back to Game Day U, powered by Hebert Financial. The Tulsa Golden Hurricane have arrived. They're behind us right now going into the stadium. Coach Bob Stoops' weekly press conference was this week, and he talked about last week's win against Tennessee and the challenge that the Golden Hurricane presents to the Sooners.
Recapping last week's game with Tennessee, once again, just really proud of our players' effort and resilience they showed throughout the game at Tennessee there last week.
The win against Tennessee was a big one, but Coach Bob Stoops isn't overlooking this weekend's matchup against the Tulsa Golden Hurricanes. The Sooners are returning to Norman undefeated. But so is Tulsa. The Sooners are a heavy favorite to win, but the Tulsa offense has caught Stoops' attention.
You know, I think it's good for the state. I think for both teams, it's good. You know, when you look at fans, when you look at even us, travel expenses and you know, just the convenience of traveling to each other. You know, we go there. We've been there a couple of times. And you know, I think for all those reasons, it's positive. Yeah, it doesn't surprise me. Phil does a great job, and you know, they've been effective running and throwing. So you know, we're very aware of that. But I again, it doesn't surprise me. I thought he would do a really good job, and he is. And you know, and I'd like and think the world of Bill Young too. You know, I think he's an awesome coach. And. And, you know, so they're doing a really good job. Yeah, definitely. No question. They'll wear you out running the football if you try and get, you know, too extravagant in your coverages, you know. So definitely they can run the ball.
Courtney Boggs, Game Day U.
Game Day U powered by Hebert Financial. I'm here with Carson Williams, Reagan Ledbetter, and Clarke Sachs. We're just having a good time here in Norman, Oklahoma. The Tulsa Golden Hurricane have just arrived. Those buses you see behind us are filled with Golden Hurricane players ready to take on the Oklahoma Sooners today. Let's talk about this game today. And first off, let's talk about OU. Is there – Bob Stoops said that his favorite win was last week against Tennessee. He later changed that and said he probably had some other favorites.
He liked the national championship.
Yeah, he liked the national championship.
That was a bold statement. Yeah.
So let's talk about your favorite win of the Bob Stoops era. It's his 100th game here at Owen Field, 100 consecutive sellout. It's a good time, if any, to reflect on the Bob Stoops era as a whole. What's your favorite win, Carson?
Obviously, the national championship was special. I was a little bit too young to fully remember it. And then, you know, obviously in 2014, the Sugar Bowl was momentum changing. But personally, I think OU Tech in 2008, Tech was ranked number two in the nation coming in here. The Red Raiders came in here and got destroyed.
Yeah, they
that
did.
Crowd was as loud as I've seen any crowd here in a long time. It was pretty special.
Reagan, what's your favorite?
You look good in glasses.
Yeah, where'd you get those?
Yeah, I'm Houdini when it comes to my glasses.
You know? I looked away and I looked back and you had glasses on.
Yeah.
You look so much smarter.
This is the Mason thanks, Prince
man.
Magic
I appreciate
show.
It right here. Yeah, that's how I do. But what's your favorite win, Reagan?
To me, it has to be the Sugar Bowl win. I mean, come on.
It's yeah.
Just the hype for that game. I mean, they're supposed to just get blanked, like beat down. And when I was watching, I'm like, there's no way they're going to win this game. There's no way. And then all of a sudden, the Sooner Magic starts coming out.
Yeah.
And then boom. But at the same time, last week's game, being there, that environment, nothing for three quarters, and all of a sudden, bam, football.
They come alive.
Yeah.
Is finally being played. And to see that whole 105,000 of just that powder orange just go silent.
Yeah.
It's probably the greatest thing I've ever experienced in my entire life.
Clarke?
For me, it's a game that I've been to. I think those are the best games when you're actually there to experience it.
So Tennessee?
That was 2008 against Texas Tech.
Yeah.
I was there with my dad, so shout out dad for taking me to that game. But, I mean, it's one of the things where you had DeMarco Murray, Sam Bradford, Jermaine Gresham. You had that amazing team all on the field together, put up 65 points against Tech. And Tech was number two and undefeated at the time. And I think that was, for me, one of the most special games. You had Jump Around, which, you know, got played for the first time.
Yeah.
And the fans went crazy. I think it was the best atmosphere.
For me, it, like you said, it's the games that you're at. And for me, it's the Tennessee game. Because last week, I have never experienced anything like that.
Yeah.
Just how loud it was in the stadium, the implications for that game. We'll talk about the implications for that game a little bit later. But you go into a game, SEC country, where you haven't been in a while, and you go on the road and win in a hostile environment, and the way you win, to me, is just amazing. You're downtrodden, you're down and out for three quarters, and then Sooner Magic comes into play in the fourth. It's just it was an amazing thing to witness last week.
It's amazing what a game like that can do for a team going forward. For both sides. I mean, Tennessee, they lost that game, but that's just a wake-up call. That's like, we had this wrapped up against Oklahoma.
Yeah.
Not some podunk team, Oklahoma.
Not Lamar.
Not Lamar.
And so, I mean, it was just a big win for OU.
It was. Let's talk about that win a little bit. Is there any hangover effect for this team for OU this week? Because after a big win like that, and you're coming up against a Tulsa opponent who's still good. Granted, they're a good team, but you're not playing a conference game. You're not playing a Tennessee, a team that is that good and has that high of a profile. Is there any hangover effect, Carson?
I think there is a little bit. You know, like I said earlier, it all comes down to the offensive line. You know, they've been very shaky through the first two games. And, you know, kind of like, you know, Clarke said, they're going to have Ty Darlington, Nila Casatati not up to full strength. You know, they didn't get Baker time to throw. Last week, they really didn't. And you know, they also haven't been very good run blocking. So I think all of those factors are going to, you know, coming to play this week, today here in a little bit against Tulsa.
OU has a bye week next week, Reagan. Do you think they look ahead to that at all and overlook Tulsa and just they're ready to get a break?
I'll tell you what, they can. I mean, when you're playing a team that's averaging 600 yards, I don't care who it is. They're putting up that many yards a game. And so this is a game. But for OU, this should be just a game. They come back and just go all out and just whip up on Tulsa. You have that big come from behind win last week. You're finally home in front of your home crowd, a sellout. Hang a half a hundred on them.
Yeah.
That's all I'm saying.
Any hangover, Clarke?
I think there is. These are the games that underdogs love. When you get an early 11 a.m. kickoff after the favorite team has just come off a huge emotional win, that's when a lot of times you see these upsets happen. I don't think it's going to be an upset, but I think that it's going to provide a little bit of a hangover effect. Guys aren't at full strength on the offensive line. It's an early game. Physical, emotional game last week. It's just going to take a while for them to kind of get it going.
Yeah. This is a bigger game than I think a lot of OU fans think it is. Mm-hmm. Because TU comes in undefeated. They're averaging over 600 yards a game of offense. They have a running back, Zach Langer, who's been playing very, very well. They have a quarterback, Dane Evans, who can throw it out of the stadium. The dude's got a cannon. And this OU team was tested last week. They're tired. And they said it at availability on Monday and Tuesday. They're sore. Baker Mayfield was still sore on Wednesday. It's a big game for OU, and a lot of OU fans don't might realize that, Carson.
Oh, yeah, definitely. You know, they, like we've talked about, that offense is very potent. And OU's defense last week for the first, you know, pretty much first half, was working effortlessly to try to stop Josh Dobbs in that Tennessee offense. So I think you're right. I think today they will probably come out, you know, slow, sluggish a little bit. But I think, you know, second quarter, I think they're going to pick it up, and that's when things are going to start rolling for them.
All right, we're looking far down the road here, but with the win last week, how do you feel about OU's Final Four contention, Clarke?
I'm still I wouldn't put them in my Final Four. The reason why is that they haven't really put together a complete game.
Yeah.
Especially when what you see what they did last week. I don't think that if they were to have an Ohio State, that they would be able to hang with them for three quarters and then just hope that in the fourth quarter, everything starts clicking. The defense still has to improve. And if you can't put up any points, really, you can put 3 points until the fourth quarter against Tennessee on the road. I don't feel like that offense is where it needs to be anywhere near a title contention when you got teams like Ohio State, you know, LSU or Alabama, one of those two teams. Yeah. I think it's still way too early to think that OU is kind of in that that discussion.
If I'm being honest, I don't know what I'm going to see from OU until the final three games of the season, where OSU, TCU, and Baylor back to back to back. That's where I think I'll see the most out of OU. Reagan, do you agree?
Yeah, there's with this team, I swear you never know what's going to happen. I mean, they could come out today and put up 30 points in the first half, or they could put up 0 points in the first quarter. I don't think we can talk about them being in the Final Four or any kind of playoff contention yet. But at the same time, the way this defense is looking,
And the offensive line. That's another big problem with the offensive line.
The offensive line needs to improve, Carson.
Yeah, it definitely does. I've been saying that all morning today.
Yeah.
But last week I do think put OU on the map. Maybe not, you know, up in the serious contention. Exactly. Yes. I think we're gonna have to wait and see what Tennessee does the rest of the year. If they can, you know, come out of the SEC East and, you know, play for that SEC championship game, I think it'll look great for OU and the College Football Playoff Committee. It'll be hard for them to ignore that.
I don't know about you guys, but this week at availability, talking to the players, talking to the coaches, there seems to be, I don't know, a sense of pride maybe that wasn't there when the season started. Yeah. A sense of like, hey, we can do this.
Yeah.
Is that kind of the feeling you got, Clarke?
I mean, I definitely think that's the sense there, but it's so early, you really don't want to make any real big judgments yet. And I think it all comes down to what you said, where it's the last three games is where we're really going to find out what happens. Even if they've got all this feeling where they're like, we can do this, we're not going to know how well until they're actually tested at the end of the season.
It seems like this team, more than last year, is just having more fun, Reagan. It seems like they enjoy being around you. Last year, it felt kind of like a solemn mood, like it was a job. And now, it doesn't feel that way to me. Does it feel that way to you?
Because they're winning.
Yeah. Because they're winning.
For now.
It's easy to have fun and be happy when you're 2-0. If they would have lost last week, I guarantee you. But at the same time, I agree with that. I mean, at availability, you interview the players and you just sense a jokingly and kind of fun attitude. I mean, Charles Tapper joking about that scoop and score. They just seem so, I messed it up, but who cares? I'll think about my touchdown dance for the next game.
Yeah.
So there's just a different sense of, I guess, urgency for this team this year. And so it'll be interesting to see how that plays out going forward.
Well, you know, last year this time after OU beat Tennessee, they ranked fourth in the nation. So they were in serious contention to play for that first college football playoff, you know, semifinal. But things started to go downhill. I think this year, because they aren't so, you know, looked at and, you know, they're not under so much pressure.
Jeez.
That
scared me.
Whoa. All right. It's game day here in Norman.
Sooner in the building.
It is game day here in Norman. Morning. They're excited to be here. I'm excited to be here. But like I was saying, what was I saying? Thank you. Thank you, vehicle.
Yeah, lose our train of thought here.
Take it away, man.
We'll tell you what, we'll take it to a break now. When we come back, we'll talk the OU offense and defense and look how they prepared for Tulsa. It's Game Day U, powered by Hebert Financial, here with Carson Williams, Reagan Ledbetter, and Clarke Sacks. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
Hebert Financial Services is a full-service, family-owned business that offers comprehensive financial planning. They work hard to design strategies to help you reach your financial goals.
Having a full-service, holistic financial planning firm, it's evolved to estate planning attorneys, CPAs, financial planners.
They assist with wills, trusts, asset protection, and much more. It's really about understanding what people are going through as they enter new stages in their life. With over 25 years of experience, Hebert Financial Services can help you reach your financial goals.
Fun fact, the Sooners' offense has started slow the first 2 weeks, and it's not what the fans were expecting under Lincoln Riley. The Sooner offense is going to look to get off to a fast start this week against Tulsa. Game Day U Stephen Mudd has more.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, I felt like, throughout the whole game, I was just praying to God and talking to my dad, saying, you know, let us get something big. And it finally came, and, you know, it was kind of emotional.
Two games and two slow starts for the Sooners offense. This week, they will face a Tulsa defense that is allowing over 300 yards of offense per game. The OU offense looks to limit mistakes and get off to a better start against the Golden Hurricane.
Our mentality is probably further along than I expected. And if our execution will catch up to our mentality, then we could be pretty good. But right now we're a pretty tough-minded unit that, but we still make just way, way, way too many mistakes. So
slow starts. That's us. That's offense. I mean, they're stopping them. I mean, they're not giving up any points really. So that's us. That's attention to detail. Like I said, that's errors that we don't make in practice. The two interceptions that I threw were on hitch routes that we throw 300 times a week, and we don't do that during practice. So that's stuff that we have to go out and execute, even when it's a big game.
Yeah, I think that that definitely helps. I mean. We have so many young guys on the line right now, and you can kind of see them, get into the crowd and, start getting overhyped up. And as an older guy, you kind of know that you got to kind of conserve your energy and, get your mind focused. Don't be too focused on the crowd. So that's just a teaching moment for them, and you got to pull them to the side and let those guys know, just chill out a little bit. We got to go out here and take care of business.
Game Day U, Stephen Mudd.
Thanks, Stephen. We are back here. It is windy. The wind comes sweeping down the plain.
It's that golden hurricane.
The golden hurricane is blowing in. But let's talk about the Sooners offense first. Guys, the offensive line last week had a tough, tough game. Orlando Brown in particular. What needs to change on this offensive line? Carson, you've been talking about it all day, so I'll start with you.
Oh, boy. Here we go. Okay. I think really what needs to change, I just think these guys need to get reps. Orlando Brown is the freshman on that offensive line, true freshman. So he just needs to get reps. I think that's going to be the big thing for him.
Yeah, they got no help for Baker Mayfield last week, Reagan.
I think it's just the chemistry. I mean, these guys haven't played together in real games very, very much. I mean, other than Darlington, no one's really had a lot of experience. And you have a young guy, that just causes all kinds of problems. But I think the big thing is penalties.
Yeah.
You can't win games if you give the other team yards on that many penalties, and you can't win games if you're OU if you can't run the ball at all.
Yeah.
I mean, so I think you just pound the ball with Mixon and Piron until the offensive line figures it out.
Clarke?
I think you just got to get back to the basics. Don't try and worry about doing too much. Just nice, simple run game, because with all these guys, it's like Carson said, they're a little inexperienced. They just need reps. Get them some reps. Just ease them into the game. Guys like Orlando Brown, they've got a whole lot of potential, and I don't think one game is going to define him as an offensive lineman at OU. But when you look at how – I don't know if it was nerves. I don't know if it was just being underprepared. He just wasn't ready at all. When the penalties that Reagan talked about, that came down to Orlando Brown. I think they just go back to the basics, start running the ball, pound it on the ground, and that'll help these guys get settled in.
Coach Stoops said on Monday that he thought Orlando Brown had a good game, and I had to do a double take and be like, are you sure? Are you sure you mean Orlando Brown? Maybe you mean either Costati or someone else, but – he said Orlando Brown, so
he's got the confidence
of Bob Stoops, so that's a good thing. Let's talk now about the wide receivers and how they played last week. Is it still the Sterling Shepard show? Because last year, that's what kind of hurt the Sooners, that it was Sterling Shepard and everyone else was just kind of there.
I think that last week kind of skewed a little bit because Sterling Shepard was the big hero. He had the big plays, but when you look at it, he leads the team with 10 receptions, and then you got Westbrook with 7, Neal with 6. It's not like he's blowing it out of the water. These receivers have had some good games, especially week one with Westbrook against Akron. I think Sterling Shepard's still the main guy. He's always going to be the main guy until this season's over and he's gone. But I think that there are a lot more receivers who are starting to kind of, they're stepping it up. They're letting Sterling Shepard kind of, I don't want to say take some time off, but he's not having to carry the load like he did last year.
Reagan?
No, I totally agree with that. I mean, having so much depth at receiver this year, I mean, Shep's the guy. At the end of the game, like last week, he's the guy you're going to go to. But having guys like Dede and Baxter, who you have to watch for, takes the pressure off Shep, takes the coverage off Shep, and leaves him wide open, and that just does wonders for this football team.
Carson?
To me, we wouldn't even be talking about this if it wasn't for his nagging groin injury last year that really kept him out most of the second half of the season. Like you guys have said, he has a lot more help in those wide receiving groups. You know, we've got Dede, Westbrook, Jarvis Baxter. People aren't really talking about Jeff Meade, but he's a big guy who can really go up and get balls. So I think that could be one of those guys who could really take pressure off of Sterling.
Well, we say Jeff Meade
didn't really see much.
He didn't play against Tennessee.
And
Stoops was saying it was just kind of matchups and the way they had the matchups going, the guys on the field, they didn't want to mess it up. And it wasn't that he's been playing bad. And so who knows? This week could be completely different. He might just end up going off and it's one of those things where it's just a week by week with this offense and all the receivers. I still want to see Mark Andrews kind of get
yeah.
into the mix. He's still pretty much been non-existent.
Guys, let's talk about Joe Mixon and the Cali Cat we saw last week. Toby Roman called it the Cali Cat on the radio last week. Joe Mixon in the Wildcat formation. Bob Stoops says he needs to be a little less selfish with the ball, hand the ball off more to Samaje Perine, make the right reads, and that just comes with reps. Is this a good package for OU, Reagan?
I was surprised. I mean, I was happily surprised to see it. I think it's a great aspect of this offense. You have Mixon, who's just this five-star athlete, and you have Perine, who can just pound the ball. Either one of them can get you yards. So you haven't seen a Wildcat at OU. I mean, it's kind of odd.
Yeah.
But, I mean, it's something that's going to be very effective for this team.
I'm not too excited for it, unfortunately. I've never been a big fan of the Wildcat. I feel like...
It's either a hit or a miss.
It really worked for Arkansas back when they had Darren McFadden and Felix Jones, but I feel like it's too predictable. It's the read option. You know one of them's going to get it. I'm not worried about Baker Mayfield out on the outside trying to go down and make a catch in the end zone, and that also puts him at risk for injury because if you throw him out there, guys can hit him.
Yeah.
It's kind of where it comes the read option, and if Joe Mixon's not going to, you know, if he can stop being selfish with it, then that's one thing, but it kind of just reminds me of Trevor Knight last year because Trevor Knight would never pull the ball down and run.
Yeah.
If Mixon's just going to pull it and run every time, you kind of lose the option that you have there with Mixon and
Mixon
Perine.
Just looks uncomfortable back there. I mean, just seeing him take those snaps, he looks nervous.
Yeah.
And you can't have that if you want to try to run Wildcat.
Yeah.
I was kind of interested to see, you know, that Stoops and Lincoln Riley went with that. Aside from the Belldozer, we've never really seen anything like this. Mm-hmm. You know, Stoops never really uses these special packages. But it could be a big hit. You know, I think, like we've talked about, it's been a very slow start for this for this running game. So I think if you put, you know, Joe Mixon back there in the Cali Cat, it could definitely give him, and, you know, you could maybe throw in, you know, Samaje Perine in there a little bit, just kind of get them their carries because they haven't really had any, so far this season.
And Stoops was asked, you know, well, can Mixon throw the ball? And he said that he can throw it.
Yeah.
You know, that's going to come with time because especially on the road at Tennessee,
I find that hard to believe.
You don't want to put the guy who's only played two games back there trying to make, you know, decisions on reading the defense now when it comes to pass coverage.
Especially today with this wind, I wouldn't trust him.
Let's talk now about the guy who definitely can't throw the ball, and that's Baker Mayfield, who ran for his life last week but had a whole lot of playmaking plays last week. You saw his playmaking ability. Are you impressed with Baker Mayfield more than you were at the beginning of the season, Clark?
I definitely am, especially with when you see what he did against Tennessee, running for his life. It's two things. A, he's got the threat to run the ball. When he gets out of the pocket, if nothing's there, he'll take off. He'll get 4 or 5 yards. He doesn't put himself in danger, and that's the big thing, is that he takes what the defense gives him. He makes it easier for the next play. And until that time comes where he takes off, his eyes are downfield. He's looking for guys.
Reagan?
Oh, I'm very impressed. I mean, we didn't know much about – we knew how he played at Texas Tech, but we didn't know much about him, how he turned out at OU. But, I mean, he said in his press conference before week one, I don't get nervous. Like, everybody's asking about that. He doesn't get nervous.
Yeah.
And I believe him now. I mean, his pass to Samaje in the end zone was probably the play that basically sold me the most on how he was able to scramble out and somehow drop that ball over that defensive back.
Carson?
I think Baker could have a very big game today. Like I've been saying, since the offensive line has been unreliable, he's having to show his ability to make plays outside of the pocket, and he's done a very good job out of that. You know, last week he had a ton of broken tackles against Tennessee. You know, he can make throws on the run, call his own number, get some yards on the ground if he needs to. Lincoln Riley he found his guy to run his offense, and I think Baker Mayfield is in for a great season.
Telling you, Baker Mayfield, my dark horse for the Heisman. Let's move on now and talk a little bit about the defense. The defense had a great week last week, and now this week they're playing a familiar foe, I should say, and that is former Baylor offensive coordinator Philip Montgomery, who is now the head coach of the Tulsa Golden Hurricane. Tulsa's averaging over 600 yards of offense per game, and how do the defense prepare? Well, let's find out. Still feel that way?
Oh, yeah. yeah. No, it's still my favorite one. Like I said, to end the game like that, there's no better feeling.
After a big win last week, it's time for the Sooner defense to change their focus to Tulsa and prepare for a familiar foe, TU head coach Philip Montgomery. The former Baylor offensive coordinator gave the Sooners fits in the past couple of years, and that's something the Sooner defense will hope to change on Saturday.
Yeah, we'll play more nickel in this game. This is, he's done an unbelievable job. It's the same stuff we saw at Baylor, and, you know, we struggled matching up against this type of offense. So, you know, we'll make some adjustments and see if we can come up with a better game plan and cover guys better and be tighter in coverage. But, you know, to average 600 yards in the first two games, you know, I don't care who you're playing. That's, you know, that's pretty special.
Oh, yeah, and they got the same game plans as Baylor. So we struggled with that in the past. So it's going to be fun to get out there and compete against one of the Baylor's offensive coordinators. This Tulsa has a lot of explosive skill positions. Their O-line is pretty good. So it's going to be a lot of fun to get out there. They're going to let us rush the passer a little bit, and hopefully we can get some sacks out there.
Yes, just a lot of Baylor. That's really what we think of, you know, TU and their offense and stuff like that. I mean, they basically are like a Baylor. And, you know, they're gonna run the same type of stunts and, you know, same type of plays, we feel like.
Clarke Sachs, GamedayU.
And they can't stop Langer. Third time is the charm, and we're an extra point away from.
Guys, let's talk about the defense now. Carson, the defensive line had a great week last week.
Yeah, you know, Charles Walker, Charles Tapper, Matt Diamond, and Matt Romar. Two Charles, two Matts. They were great last week.
That was
week.
Good.
That is.
That was clever.
You know, last week they really disrupted Josh Dobbs, especially in the second half. You know, they just disrupted him. I don't know what else to say. Carson's having a rough day today.
Reagan, what'd you see from the defense?
To me, it's all about that secondary. I mean, just nothing but problems last year. Problems, communication problems. And look at this. They're actually playing like they're a D1 secondary.
From 117th to 6th. That's impressive.
And yeah. What I like the most is they aren't bragging about it or praising that. All of them have said, yeah, we're 6th. We've played two games.
Cool.
We've not proved anything. After last year, and I agree.
Yeah, I mean, just ask Baylor playing against Lamar, you know. First two games, stats may
not
mean
a whole lot. Who is Lamar? Who is this guy?
How many times has Lamar been set on this set today? I swear.
It'll probably be brought up a lot more throughout the year.
Exactly. It will be.
That's what happens when you schedule a team like Lamar.
Yeah,
you're going to get
I mean, I think one of the big things is the depth on the defensive line. It's something they didn't really have last year. You bring in a whole bunch of guys. You can use situational guys now. You got guys for rushing the passer, you got guys for clogging up holes. Guys like Matt Diamond, they haven't really been able to rush the passer very well, but they've really done their job at stopping the run. Charles Walker's a little bit of everything. He's getting back there, and he is putting pressure on all these QBs. And then when you also look at the outside with Stryker and Bond, kind of the D-line outside linebacker mix, it really gives them a whole new, like, ability to just rush the passer.
One guy we haven't talked about yet is Devontae Bond, who had an amazing game last week. Seemed to be around the ball every single play. What is he bringing this defense, Reagan?
He's a version of Stryker.
Yeah.
But bigger. I mean, he's good off the edge. He's always by the ball. He probably is up there in tackles on this defense right now.
Yeah.
And he's just so quiet. I mean, even interviewing him, he's just very, doesn't have much to say, man of few words.
Yeah, he's a very quiet guy.
But he performs on the field, and that's all that matters.
Yeah. Seven tackles last week, two sacks, and a forced fumble.
Yeah.
That's unbelievable.
Yeah, that's big time. You know, I've always thought that this linebacker group is one of OU's best position groups. And with, you know, Devontae Bond playing like he did last week, if he can do that for the whole season, this linebacker group has a chance to be one of OU's best.
Well, we talked about the defense. We talked about the offense. Coming up next, we're going to talk about the Tulsa Golden Hurricane and what they bring to the table, their personnel, their coaching staff, and much, much more. Stay with us. It's GamedayU, powered by Hebert Financial.
Hebert Financial Services is a full-service, family-owned business that offers comprehensive financial planning. They work hard to design strategies to help you reach your financial goals.
Having a full-service, holistic financial planning firm, it's evolved to estate planning attorneys, CPAs, financial planners.
They assist with wills, trusts, asset protection, and much more. It's really about understanding what people are going through as they enter new stages in their life. With over 25 years of experience, Hebert Financial Services can help you reach your financial goals.
Welcome back to GamedayU, powered by Hebert Financial, Mason Prince, Carson Williams, Reagan Ledbetter, and Clarke Sacks, getting you all your information before kickoff. The Tulsa Golden Hurricane is here in Norman to take on the Oklahoma Sooners. We already know a whole lot about the offense, so let's go ahead and talk about the defense. Clarke, give me what you know.
Well, with the defensive line, it's not something that the Sooners need to be too concerned about, which is good when they've got a banged-up offensive line. First two games, this D-line's only got two sacks and five tackles for a loss. They're not very good. They've given up 262 yards per game. They've got size, but they just haven't really been productive, so I think it's going to be a real big benefit for this OU offensive line. But, I mean, one guy to look out for is defensive end Derek Alexander, Dominique Alexander's brother.
Yes.
So that's going to be something to really look for.
Carson, go ahead and talk to me about the linebackers.
For the linebackers, to me, it's you know, there's three guys. Craig Suits, who was on Phil Steele's preseason All-AAC third team.
Yeah.
And then you've got two Jinx guys. You're a big Jinx guy.
That's right.
So this is going to hit home for you. Linebacker Matt Linscott and linebacker Trent Martin. Both of them combined 38 tackles, the second and third leading tacklers on the team. So, you know, OU passing offense today could have a little bit of trouble because those guys are big-time players for Tulsa.
Reagan, speaking of the OU passing offense, tell me what they're going to have to deal with the DBs.
See, I disagree with that. They're giving up like 35 points a game right now, and they don't have a lot of big playmakers. I mean, not really many interceptions for the DBs, but the big guy I'm watching is Darrell Williams. He's a vet. He's top on the secondary in tackles, so I'm curious to see how they turn out against this high-powered OU passing offense.
Darrell Williams, didn't he just play for OU?
Yeah, I thought so. Who knows?
He lost a few pounds, got a little
good
faster.
For him.
Got an extra year of eligibility somewhere.
He's got it somewhere.
Look at him.
He's got it somewhere. All right, let's go ahead and move to the offense, averaging 600 yards a game. So let's go ahead and talk about that. Clarke, what do you got on the receivers?
There's two guys you got to know. That's Keevan Lucas. He had 14 catches, 258 yards, three touchdowns so far this year. He had 1,200 yards receiving last year. And then Kiaris Garrett, 12 catches, 265 yards. After that, they've only got guys with four catches for 46 yards. So when it comes down to it, Keevan Lucas and Kiaris Garrett, they're going to be big matchups for this secondary because they love to throw the ball. Those are the only two guys you got to know. It's going to be up to Sanchez and Thomas. Can they finally lock them down?
Who they got in the backfield, Carson? And tell me it's a Jinx guy.
I'm looking at Zach Langer.
It's another a Jinx guy! There we go. I like it.
Again, another kid on Phil Steele's preseason All-AAC. God, that's hard to get.
It is.
All-AAC third team. And then you also have D'Angelo Brewer. Langer and Brewer, both of those guys have a combined 93 carries, 453 yards, and five touchdowns through two games.
Yeah.
But OU's running defense has been spectacular so far in the first two games, only allowing 133 yards per game. So one of those is going to have to give today.
Langer has scored the game-winning touchdown in both of Tulsa's wins so far this season, the first one in overtime in week number one and then the second one in the fourth quarter against New Mexico last week. Reagan, what do you see out of the quarterback, Dane Evans?
He's a big factor, 745 yards on the year, four touchdowns, just one interception. He's just putting up. I mean, he's the fourth leading passer in the nation right now. Struggled last year against OU. Struggled big time.
Yeah, I did.
That
in
pick
the rain.
Six, that, yeah, the, in the rain, that pick six to Gino.
Yep.
So he's a big guy. It's another year under his belt. He's playing OU again. We'll see. I mean, the way he's passing right now, if I was OU, I'd be a little worried.
Better offense for him this year, too.
Much better.
No doubt.
Yeah, OU secondary is going to have their hands full today. I think they're up to the challenge, though. Stephen Parker, Zach Sanchez, Jordan Thomas, and Ahmad Thomas. I think they're going to be ready for Dane Evans and these
receivers. One of the big things is going to be, because it's so heavy on the passing game, they're better at covering than they are tackling, and that's going to really play to OU's strengths, I feel like.
I think you're right. Well, that's it on Tulsa. Coming up next, it's our final segment where we give you our final word, our game predictions, and yes, call-outs, the game that is sweeping the nation besides four downs. We'll be right back with GamedayU, presented by Hebert Financial.
Hebert Financial Services is a full-service family-owned business that offers comprehensive financial planning. They work hard to design strategies to help you reach your financial goals.
Having a full-service, holistic financial planning firm. It's evolved to estate planning attorneys, CPAs, financial planners.
They assist with wills, trusts, asset protection, and much more. It's really about understanding what people are going through as they enter new stages in their life. With over 25 years of experience, Hebert Financial Services can help you reach your financial goals.
Welcome back to GamedayU, powered by Hebert Financial. I'm here with Carson Williams, Reagan Ledbetter, and Clarke Sachs, and a special guest. Her name is Riley. Where are you from, Riley?
I'm from Bixby, Tulsa.
You're from Bixby. I'm from Tulsa too. I live at 101st Memorial.
That's we got crazy. One of our crew back here who's from Bixby.
Yeah, we got some Bixby Spartans here.
Yeah,
we got
I'm not.
A lot of Bixby Spartans here. How many OU games have you been to?
Well,
this is like our first one.
This is your first game?
Yeah, it's our first one.
What's your name?
My name's Shawnee.
Shawnee?
This is your first game. What are you looking forward to most about being at this game?
How many times I can go around it.
That is the best
start
answer.
Start exploring.
Are you guys huge OU fans?
Pretty much, yeah.
Yeah. Not Tulsa fans?
Well, we're kind of both.
Oh,
you got to pick one or the other today.
Yeah, I understand that. I'm from Tulsa. I mean, I root for OU though. You guys like Baker Mayfield?
Hmm?
The quarterback? Are you quarterback? You like Baker Mayfield?
Yeah.
Yeah. Of course, every girl loves him.
You guys know that you're here for head coach Bob Stoops' 100th game here at Owen Field. You know that? It's his 100th game. It's his 100th game. He is 91-8.
100th consecutive sellout.
Big time. It's big time. You guys excited for that?
Yeah.
Yeah, you excited for
hey,
that?
Hey, Mason.
Yeah.
Let me give him a little bit of advice. When you guys get in the stadium, you got to get a foot-long corn dog.
Yeah.
Best get thing to do in the stadium.
Get a foot-long corn dog.
Those are big time.
Go for it. What's your favorite stadium food?
Hers is probably cotton candy.
Okay.
She eats it 24/7.
The sweet tooth. 24/7? Mm-hmm. You like cotton candy? What's your favorite?
Hot dogs.
All right.
The hot dogs.
Yeah.
You got
to go wrong with the hot
dogs. You
got
dog. You got to get those. Those are the best part. All right. Who wins the game, guys? Tulsa or OU?
Do I have to choose?
Yeah.
Yep.
We're putting you on the spot.
And the right, score. And the score.
I switched to her.
Okay.
Why?
Who do you got?
I kind of want to root for Tulsa.
Whoa. We got a golden hurricane. We got a hurricane fan here. Well, thank you guys so much for joining us. I hope you guys enjoy your first OU game. You guys excited?
Yeah.
You excited?
All right. You guys have fun. Big round of applause for our guests today here on GamedayU. They were very excited. All right, guys. We'll be right back after this. GamedayU powered by Hebert Financial. Stay with us.
Hebert Financial Services is a full-service family-owned business that offers comprehensive financial planning. They work hard to design strategies to help you reach your financial goals.
Having a full-service, holistic financial planning firm, it's evolved to estate planning attorneys, CPAs, financial planners.
They assist with wills, trusts, asset protection, and much more. It's really about understanding what people are going through as they enter new stages in their life. With over 25 years of experience, Hebert Financial Services can help you reach your financial goals.
Welcome back to GamedayU, powered by Hebert Financial. We're
live
back.
Live TV.
We're back. Live TV. We got the band marching behind us into the stadium.
In the wind.
Where?
Oh, there they are. They're excited for today's game. Hopefully they're excited to get whooped up on by the Oklahoma Sooners.
The wind comes sweeping down the plane.
The winds come sweeping.
They brought that golden hurricane.
Oh, man.
They brought the hurricane. There's no hurricanes in Tulsa. I don't know if you ever knew that.
And I didn't know that hurricanes are usually golden.
Yes.
That's the official color,
Tulsa,
I guess.
Tulsa.
You've never seen those red hurricanes, Clark?
Tulsa in Oklahoma as a state in general is landlocked. So the golden hurricane, I am very confused as to why that is a
mascot.
A
golden tornado or something like that.
But hey, also, you guys want a fun fact. One of the only colleges where it's a singular mascot, the golden hurricane.
That's right.
There's your second Clarke Sachs fun fact of the day.
The Stanford Cardinals.
The Clarke Sachs fun fact of the day. The drum line. The drum line is behind us right now. We got OU fans here. We're just a little over an hour from kickoff today. We will now get you to our final segment where we give you our call-outs, our final word, and our game prediction. We will start with Carson Williams. Give me your national call-out.
I'm going to have to go with the Auburn Tigers. Yeah. Guys, I picked you for my top football playoff, and you let me
playoffs?
Down. You're embarrassing me.
It's terrible. That's a terrible
come
pick.
Come on, man.
This is terrible
come
pick.
On. Near upset last week against Jacksonville State. Jeremy Johnson, I'm looking at you. This is your team, and you were the guy to run this team, and you have severely underachieved right now.
All right, Clarke Sachs, give me your fun fact. Who's your call out?
I'm calling out Notre Dame. with all their injuries against Georgia Tech, this is a game that they can still win. I don't think this is something that they need to be worried about because, I mean, hey, fun fact, Notre Dame did it with their third-string quarterback last year.
Fun fact.
I'm calling out Notre Dame. It's Georgia Tech. It's going to be different with the triple option, but Notre Dame can get this done. They're my call out.
Reagan.
Close. DeShone Kizer, actually.
Okay.
I mean, it's your time to shine, bud. I mean, you're the starting quarterback now. You're young, but you're leading a team that has contention to be possibly a Final Four team. You're undefeated.
Yeah.
You're playing a tough Georgia Tech team. Go out there and put up numbers today.
I'm going to call out the BYU Mighty Fighting Cougars. The Storm and Mormons there in Utah, they are going to beat UCLA today. And here's why. Because they are a team of destiny, my friends. A team of destiny. And I believe in you, BYU Cougars. Two Hail Marys. Who cares? Have a third one today. I don't really care. You got a backup quarterback. That's not going to stop you. UCLA Bruins, when's the last time they were good at football? I don't remember. Go beat them today. Show them why you are a Cinderella story to lead the pack. Caddyshack? Anybody? Caddyshack reference?
Caddyshack.
No, okay. Thank you.
Almost funny, Mason.
Almost funny. Thank you, Reagan Ledbetter. Why don't you go ahead and give me your OU call out for today then?
Oh, Orlando Brown for sure. I mean, come on.
I think everybody needs to call out Orlando Brown.
350 of them? I mean, yeah. You have all the size.
stop somebody and don't hold. You don't need to hold. You're too big.
Yeah.
Step in their way, I swear.
Yeah.
Like, seriously.
Clarke Sacks.
I'm going with the OU fans. After what we saw last week at Tennessee and what their fans can do, I really want to see the OU fans finally.
Better keep quiet about that.
Yeah. Oh, I don't care. I'll pull Bob Stoops. I'll call them out.
So that's
right. I want to see the fans because it's an 11 a.m. kickoff against Tulsa. I want to see the fans get into it, and I want to see that sustained for the rest of the season.
Carson Williams.
I'm going to go with the guy that's in charge of Orlando Brown, Bill Beedenbow.
Bill Beedenbow.
That offensive line, like I've been talking about all day, is atrocious so far through these first two games. So it's up to Bill Beedenbow to get those guys in check. Orlando Brown is that freshman X factor on the offensive line. He needs help. He needs to get better. Otherwise, Baker Mayfield could get hurt.
I'm going to go ahead and call out the OU secondary as a whole. They're sixth in the nation right now in pass defense. That's very, very good. They're going up against an OU or a TU offense that's very, very talented. Oh, the OU secondary today needs to have a great game if they want to just blow out TU, and I think they will. I think Jordan Thomas, Ahmad Thomas, Stephen Parker, and Zach Sanchez will have a great game today, and I think they lead OU to victory. I think they have about two interceptions today. I'm calling it right now. Two interceptions.
All right,
fair enough. That's a bold prediction in the last segment that you guys weren't ready for. Were you at home?
Interceptions they
weren't
ready. By who?
Interceptions by Zach Sanchez and my boy Stephen Parker.
Whoa.
Stephen Parker. A jinx guy, folks. A jinx guy. He's going to make an interception today.
Is this just a jinx reunion on the field?
It absolutely is. You're going to see me on the field saying, hey, you're going to be on the
field.
Yeah, we're going to be on the field. You're going to see me with all my jinx guys who actually played while I was on the sideline. I'm going to be saying hey to all those guys. Hey, remember me? I gave you water. Remember me? Yeah, it's going to be that kind of thing. All right,
yes.
Guys. Let's talk about now our final word. Give me one word that's going to describe today's game. Carson, we'll go with you first.
Hangover. We already talked about that.
Hangover.
But people are wondering if OU is going to have that hangover from last week. And like I said earlier, absolutely, this team started off slow the first two games. I see no reason why this is any different. 11 o'clock game. I just think that, you know, they're going to start slow again. But I think they're going to pick it up. So I think it won't be too big of a deal.
Right. Mine's fast. I mean, this is your last game before you start Big 12 play. If you can't start fast against Tulsa, then it's going to be a long year. That's all I'm saying.
Mine's routine. I think people are expecting something big after last week against Tennessee. I think it's just going to be kind of an easy game. It's going to be boring compared to last game probably, so it's just a routine game for OU beating up on a lesser team.
Yeah. I'm going to go ahead and say my word is rain. Rain, R-E-I-G-N, because rain cane is what they say in Tulsa when you're rooting for the Golden Hurricane. The Golden Hurricane need to have a good game today. Try not to get embarrassed here on this field in Norman. And OU needs to rain in the fact that they need to own Tulsa like they have for the past few years. Show them that you own this state. Tulsa, who's Tulsa? You don't know who they are. You know who the University of Oklahoma is, and that is why OU needs to reign supreme today, and Rain Kane needs to be very, very quiet. All right, guys, give me one guy today who's going to be the difference maker for the Oklahoma Sooners.
I'm going to say Samaje Perine. I think, you know, he hasn't gotten, you know, what he was, you know, capable of doing. He hasn't really done that so much this year because the offensive line has been, a little let down,
yeah.
I guess you could say.
Yeah.
But I think Samaje Perine somehow finds a way to get it done. You know, last week with that one touchdown catch, I think you might see something out of that from him today, which could be a big difference maker.
Reagan.
Mine has to be Mixon. I mean, I think this is the day that he just goes off. He finally shows Sooner Nation and in America as a whole what he's all about. I could see him putting up 200
yards. Whoa, this
win!
We might be blown away just a bit here.
Goodness gracious, yeah.
God,
this wind is crazy, man.
It's killing my vibe.
Yep. All right,
I'm going to go with Atari Bird. I think a big presence at safety position to help out the corners with all the deep threats that Tulsa's going to throw at OU is going to be big. So if Atari Bird can really lock down some coverage over the top, I think that takes a lot of pressure over the corners on the outside. So I'm going to go with Atari Bird because we got to get something over the top. Some of these times, Zach Sanchez, he still gets beat. He got beat against Akron. That worries me. So if Atari Bird can help him out, I think that'll be a big factor.
Yeah. My guy is going to be Eric Stryker, just because Tulsa's going to throw the ball a lot. You need to get pressure on Tulsa. Dane Evans likes to get the ball out of his hands very, very quickly. So you're going to need to get a whole lot of pressure on him. Eric Stryker, we haven't heard a lot from him this year. He only has half a sack on the season.
A lot of double teams.
A lot of double teams, which is expected. Because he's one of the greatest players in the nation when it comes to rushing the passer, and you're going to have to double team him. But
that's where
today,
Devontae Bond comes
exactly,
in.
Exactly, and that's why Devontae Bond had a good game last
week,
is because Tennessee keyed on him. Mm-hmm. But Eric Stryker needs to fight out those double teams. You're going to get double teamed all season long. You're Eric Stryker. You're one of the greatest players in the nation when at that position. You need to have a good game today and make some plays in the backfield, tackles for loss, sacks, cause a fumble or so.
Yeah.
Or a couple. Like, that's yeah. that's important. All right, guys. Give me a guy for Tulsa who you think you need to watch.
Gosh,
it's
that's
hard.
Tough.
That I'll give
tough.
You Zach Langer.
That's Zach Langer?
Zach Langer. That's okay. the guy you need to watch
okay.
today.
It was just so tough to pick. I don't know.
There's so well, many great
so
ones.
So many good guys.
There's so know, many on great offense. Ones. Go ahead. You want to pick a Jinx guy? Go ahead. I'll give you Trent Martin. You have Matt Lynn Scott. You want to pick
Dane Evans.
Dane Evans.
I'll take Matt Lynn Scott.
Take Matt Lynn Scott. You'll take Matt Lynn Scott. All right, guys. The TU defense. How much trouble do you think they're going to have with OU offense today?
I think they're going to have a lot of trouble because they don't have a good push up front. Their defensive line, like I said earlier, they haven't been very productive. And especially when OU is going to try and run the ball a lot today, I feel like, especially with this win, it's going to make it hard throwing. If they can't get a push up front, they're not very they don't have a whole lot of tackles for loss. They're not getting the backfield. I think the defensive line for Tulsa is going to have a rough time, and that's going to give it a lot easier for OU with this banged up offensive line.
Yeah, I think you're absolutely right. All right, guys, let's move on to our final score predictions for the game. Clarke, who you got?
I got OU 44, Tulsa 17. Okay. So I think they're going to keep this Tulsa offense in check for the most part.
Okay. Reagan.
I see a lot like last year. I say OU 52, Tulsa 14.
Okay, why do you say that?
I mean,
woo. Woo. We're
losing yeah, our we're set.
It's going on. We're doing it. We're doing it live. We're doing it live here.
I just think as OU's on a high coming off last week's big game. They're playing a home game against a lesser opponent than them. They've owned Tulsa in the past. I think it's going to be just one of those high scoring blowouts. Tulsa gets a couple maybe late touchdowns
yeah.
here and there when the OU puts their backups in and yeah. once the game's already over.
Yeah. What do you think?
I'm going to say 35-17. And an interesting thing here, in one of my classes, we were given the option to pick the final score for extra credit, and that's what I went with. I'm sticking with that.
You're sticking with it to get your extra
credit on that. I just think, you know, with this win, I think it's going to be hard to get the, you know, passing game going.
Yeah.
And so both teams are going to have to rely on the ground. So I don't think you're going to see as big of a, you know, scoring outburst as people think. I also think Tulsa is a lot better than people think. I think they managed to get 17 points.
I think Tulsa bringing this weather in might be an omen that maybe we should have picked this game a little closer.
Yeah, I mean,
maybe this weather is trying to tell us something.
I got 45-24 OU. I got a little closer than you guys. I think Tulsa's got too good of an offense to be held in check for that long. They can pass the ball. They can run the ball. They can get OU off balance. And I think towards the beginning of the game, people are going to start sweating a little bit. OU's yeah. going to get off to another slow start. You're going to be scared. It's going to be close. TU may even have a touchdown lead at one point or another. I think this game is going to be closer than a lot of people think. OU separates themselves late, and that's why you yeah. see the 21-point difference right there.
Here's the guy I'm looking forward to today, though. Austin Seibert.
Yes.
With this
that's
win,
true.
He has been phenomenal
it
so far.
Out.
Has been perfect in yeah. all of his kicks. I want to see how he does in this win.
That's right. We're here, GamedayU. That's it for us. For Carson Williams, Clarke Sacks, Reagan Ledbetter, Malik Carter, our producer, Chris Tyndall, Hunter Vick, Parker Biggs is here today. Parker Biggs, Tyler Jones, Brady doing it all
and
in
we
max
had, we
control.
Had Ken Fisher out here for
we
a little
Ken
bit.
Fisher
we got
Ken Fisher out here
Ken
for a little
Fisher.
Bit, too. So thank you for joining us here on GamedayU. Enjoy your Saturday full of college football. Boomer Sooner, have a good day.